A reading from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 15, verses 25 to 40. It was the third hour when they crucified him. The written notice of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." They crucified two robbers with him, one on his right and one on his left. And the scripture was fulfilled, which says, "He was counted with the lawless ones." Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "So, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, come down from the cross and save yourself." In the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. Let this Christ, this King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe." Those crucified with him also heaped insults on him. At the sixth hour, darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of those standing near heard this, they said, "Listen, he's calling Elijah." One man ran, filled a sponge with wine vinegar, put it on a stick and offered it to Jesus to drink. "Now leave him alone. Let's see if Elijah comes to take him down," he said. With a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus heard his cry and saw how he died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Some women were watching from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdala, Mary the mother of James the younger and of Joseph, and Salome. Thanks be to God for his word. In response to the text now, we're going to hear a beautiful meditation written and spoken for us by Elaine Butcher. This is Mary, the mother of Jesus' story. Thank you, Elaine.
I don't remember how I got there. My mind was filled with a turmoil of thoughts. I had heard about the arrest of Jesus, of course, and the trial, but crucifixion? No, it couldn't happen. He was God's son, wasn't he? It had to be a mistake. Surely it couldn't be true. On top of the hill called Golgotha, it was so noisy. Soldiers, people, onlookers, and, oh, three crosses. We edged as near as we could, and it was then I saw him hanging on the middle cross. Jesus, my son, my lovely, beautiful son. On his head was some sort of thorn wreath, which had pierced his skin, and the blood was trickling down his face, and nails through his hands and feet, so they were bleeding too. I sank to the ground in a crumpled heap, shocked and horrified. My tears were accompanied by words hammering in my brain, "Why, God? Why? This wasn't supposed to happen. I don't understand." What had the angel said to me? I was to be the mother of God's son, and God would make him a king over a kingdom which will never end. I believed it implicitly and accepted it completely. God, I don't understand. Hadn't he grown up a fine young man, a good man, a godly man? Hadn't he walked the roads from village to village, teaching, healing the sick, feeding the hungry, and freeing people from demons? I recalled the wedding at Cana, when he turned the water into wine. I was there. Until that time, I had watched, waited, and wondered. But then I knew. I opened my eyes and focused on a little flower which was struggling to grow on the barren hillside. It was so small, so beautiful, so perfect, just like the baby Jesus. Memories came flooding into my mind, the birth in the animal shelter, and the strange visitors who came, rough, simple shepherds, who had been told to come by angels, and later on, rich, wise astrologers from the East, who had followed a star. They had all come to see God's Son, because he was, wasn't he? It was a very strange situation right from the start, but Cousin Elizabeth and Zachariah had understood, and Joseph had also been given a message from God that all was well. I recalled meeting Simeon, the old man in the temple, and how he praised God that he had lived to see the Saviour of mankind, God's Son. He also said that sorrow, like a sword, would break my heart. Could he have been foretelling this very day? Raised voices and laughter drew me back to reality. It was the soldiers. They were noisily playing a game with dice. Playing a game! How could they? And then I realised it was just another day's work for them. And I heard Jesus speak. He was asking God to forgive those who had caused him to be crucified. Forgiveness for this. I steeled myself to look up at the cross, a rough, coarse piece of wood. It seemed so incongruous that Jesus, the carpenter's son, who had fashioned wood with his strong, sensitive hands, should be impaled on something so ugly. Joseph had taught him well. He was so proud of Jesus. I was relieved that Joseph, dear Joseph, was not alive to witness this. A strange darkness had spread across the sky. My friends were still with me. Through my tears, I searched for the little flower. It had been trampled on, crushed. I wept. Then I was aware of someone standing by my side, calling my name. I looked up. It was John, one of Jesus' closest friends. So they were here. I had wondered. Jesus must have noticed him too, as he called out, telling me to go home with John, and he asked John to care for me. Even in his excruciating agony, he was concerned for me. The darkness was deepening, although it was only afternoon. Rain began to fall, the drops washing our tear-stained faces. Jesus cried out again, my God, why have you forsaken me? I wanted to shout, but I'm here, Jesus, I'm here. But my voice was muted. We all knelt in silence, huddled together, exhausted. John put his hand on my shoulder and said softly, Jesus has died. He has gone to be with his Father. Come home with me, Mary. He helped me to my feet, and just as I stood, there came a flash of lightning which lit up the hillside. And my little flower was beginning to stand up. The rain was reviving it. It wasn't dead. As we walked home, I heard a voice say to me, "Let him go, Mary. Leave him with me. You trusted me once. Trust me again." And the pain in my heart started to ease.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the praise of glory dies, my riches gain, I count but loss and poor content on all my pride.
Not all Jesus' followers made the journey with him to the cross of Golgotha. It was an unpleasant place to be, a stark, desolate wasteland on the edge of the city. And those who had journeyed with Jesus, who never saw things end in this way, were overcome with fear, fear of being associated with Jesus, and fear of what the future would hold. But still, there were those that journeyed to this place, put their fear and despair aside as their love for Jesus swept away everything except the need to be with him, to see this tragedy through to its conclusion. Mary, Jesus's mother, Mary Magdala, John, the beloved disciple, to name but a few, their love for Jesus witnessed in their devotion to him. Their journey must have taken tremendous courage. They could have so easily run away. Jesus was in no position to demand their presence. And yet they were there in this darkest of places. Journeying to the dark places in our lives, the Golgothas, is never easy. These are not the places that refresh us, but sap our energy and resolve. These are the places in which we feel vulnerable and insecure. Sadly, these may be the places we have journeyed to during the pandemic. But when we find ourselves in these dark places, just as Jesus's followers gathered as a group, so too we unite with others, those who love us and value us for who we are. And at the centre of our gatherings stands Jesus, arms outstretched, open wide, as he says simply, "Come to me and I will give you peace. I will give you rest." So wherever you are this Good Friday, with family or alone, feeling secure or unsure, remember that Jesus is with you. As we kneel at the foot of the cross, may we be assured of the security, the forgiveness, the hope and the love that is ours as we look towards the resurrection of Jesus Christ on Easter Sunday, who died and rose again so that we might know the enormity of the love God has for us this day, in the days to come, and for all eternity. Amen. As we come to God in prayer, we share in prayers written by the Reverend David Clowes. And when I give the response, the Lord hears our prayer. I invite you to respond. Thanks be to God. So let us pray. God, we cry out to you in love and for love, because you are love. When life is dark and we are alone, we remember your love. When we feel isolated or used, we remember your love. When we use others and hurt them with our words and our actions, we remember your love. When life has no apparent purpose or meaning, when all we had planned has gone terribly wrong, we remember your love. Gracious God, if you were not a God of love, there would be no life. If you were not a God who loved us, there would be no reason for living. And so we come to you. Teach us to know you and your love whilst it is still light, that when the darkness comes, we may still find our way illuminated with the love of Christ. The Lord hears our prayer. Thanks be to God. Gracious God, we thank you that you have shown in us, Jesus, that everything is safe in your hands, that nothing we give back to you will ever be wasted. When the day is bright and life is good and all that we hoped for comes to fulfillment, may we be assured that we are walking in your will. When days are filled with difficulties and you seem far away, may we be assured that we are walking in your will. When we are tempted, and when we fall, when we say and do those things which are not according to your will, may we be assured that the way back into your will is still open. When we face pain or rejection, sadness or sorrow, when what we are facing feels like crucifixion, may we be assured that having committed ourselves into your hands, we are still secure, though not always in ways this world understands, yet most certainly through the grace of God in the world to come. The Lord hears our prayer. Thanks be to God. Gracious God, we cry out to you for victory. We thank you for the obedience of Christ, that though his obedience meant a cross for him, he was still faithful to you and your will. That through his obedient faithfulness, your love has triumphed over all that is evil. We come to you in the victory of Christ on the cross. We come knowing that there is no situation, no moment, no power, no weakness, no tragedy, no darkness. There is nothing that can ever defeat you and your love. We thank you that you have demonstrated in Christ's life and death that as you had the first word, so your word in Christ will always be your final word. We thank you that your love is the ultimate answer to everything we face and your final word to all your creation. May your love triumph over all that spoils your world, all that damages our lives, our relationship with you and with each other. The Lord hears our prayer. Thanks be to God. Gracious God, for a new experience of your heartwarming, life-transforming grace, for a new realization that because of Christ's life, death and resurrection, nothing will ever separate us from your love, for a new desire to enthrone Christ at the heart of our lives, and for the life-renewing spirit to empower us for worship and service. May your love hear the cry of our hearts and touch and change our lives by the good news of Good Friday. The Lord hears our prayer. To him, thanks be to God. Amen.
Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah.
Most merciful God, who by the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, delivered and saved the world, grant that by faith in him who suffered on the cross, we may triumph in the power of his victory. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.